So according to the first law of thermodynamics, the energy of an isolated system is a constant. The total energy of an isolated system is a constant. So in general, we can say energy can neither be created nor be destroyed. And so this statement is known as the law of conservation of energy. The law of conservation of energy is the same as the first law of thermodynamics. Both are the same. Energy can neither be created nor be destroyed. Or we can say the energy of, the total energy of an isolated system is a constant. You take a system, an isolated system. In an isolated system, there is neither transfer of matter nor energy. Energy or matter cannot be transferred. There is no exchange of matter and energy between the system and the surroundings. That is isolated system. Now, in an isolated system, there will be a definite amount of energy. And it is the sum of the various forms of energy, is like the translational kinetic energy, the vibrational energy, rotational energy, electronic energy, nuclear energy, potential energy, etc., etc. The sum of the various forms of energies, that is known as the internal energy of the system. And internal energy is represented by U, that is the internal energy of the system. It is the sum of the various forms of energies confined in a system. See, the internal energy is a state function. So it depends only on the initial and final states. The initial state may be an expansion. The initial state may be a compression. The initial and final states may be a reaction, chemical reaction. If it is a chemical reaction, the initial state may be regarded as the reactants. And the final state may be regarded as the products. Say at the initial stage, the internal energy is equal to U1. And in the final state, the internal energy is equal to U2. Say, for example, the energy of the reactants is equal to U1. The energy of the products, that is equal to U2. System 1, System 2. Okay. Now you take the difference in the internal energies. Final minus initial. Always you take the difference in such a way that final minus initial. Not the larger one minus the smaller one. No, it is not like that. By convention, the difference is the difference in the final and the initial. Whether it is a larger value or a smaller value, it doesn't matter. It won't affect. You take the difference of the final and the initial. And that is called the change in internal energy, delta U. That's equal to U2 minus U1. Now, U2 may be a smaller value, or U2 may be a higher value. It doesn't matter. You take the difference only. U2 minus U1. It may be a negative value. The difference may be a negative value or a positive value. That depends. So take the difference in this way. And according to the first law of thermodynamics, you can write an equation like this. Delta U is equal to Q plus W, this is from the first law of thermodynamics. From this, delta U is, there is a derivation, long derivation is there. I just skip all these things. Just remember this equation. So delta U, that is the change in internal energy, delta U is equal to Q plus W, where Q is the amount of heat absorbed, energy absorbed, heat absorbed, when heated, when the system is heated, it absorbs a definite amount of energy, it is equal to Q. The amount of heat absorbed is equal to Q. And W is the work done, it's the work done. Usually, for gases, work done is the product between pressure and volume. You will study that in physics. The work done, W, is equal to the product of the pressure and volume, that is equal to the work done. Work done is equal to pressure into volume, and that is for gases. This is the type of work done, pressure volume type of work done for gases. And if pressure is kept a constant, and if there is a difference in volume delta V, then we can write, say, work is equal to P into delta V, where P is the pressure and the delta V is the difference in volume. As before, final minus initial, But I'm going to modify this equation like this. W, work done W is equal to minus P into delta V. I have done this very intentionally. W is equal to minus P into delta V. That is the work done. Why I have used the minus sign there? You know, by convention, work done on a system, W done, work done on a system. For example, work done on a gas, work done on a system is taken as a positive value, while work done by the system, is taken as a negative value. This is by convention in chemistry. But in physics, it is just the reverse. Work done on a system is taken as negative value. Work is negative. While work done by a system is taken as a positive value. That is in physics. So please don't quarrel with the physics teacher. Their convention is like that. You know, and our convention is this. This is the NP. This is their IUPAC system of say work done. So work done on a system is taken as a positive value, and work done by a system is taken as a negative value. And so if work done W is equal to minus P into delta V, that equation will be holding good with this conviction. Say, with this value, work done on a system is positive and work done by a system is negative. And if you take this relation, W is equal to work done, W is equal to minus P into delta V, where delta V is the change in volume. That is for gases. Change in volume is appreciable only in the case of gases. For liquids and solids, there is no much effect on the change in volume. Volume will not change. Pressure has no much effect. Liquids and solids. There is no change in volume when pressure changes. But the change is for gases. They have the Boyle's law, Child's law, and all that. Boyle's law, pressure-volume relation. You have seen. So that is for gases. So this equation, W is equal to minus P into delta V. If that equation is used, That is applicable to both these conventions. That is, a work done on a system is positive, and a work done by a system is negative. And so we can write work done W is equal to minus P into delta V. Okay. Now, you can write, substitute this equation, W is equal to minus P into delta V, in the delta U equation. If you substitute that in the delta U equation, then you will get delta U is equal to, you need to study this, only the boxes. You study only the boxes. Study only the boxes. So delta U is equal to the amount of heat absorbed Q minus P into delta V, where delta V is the change in volume. Suppose the change occurs. Change occurs at a constant volume. The change occurs at a constant volume. Volume is constant. If volume is constant, then delta V is equal to, change in volume is equal to, Sharon? Change in volume, delta V is equal to, okay, I shall help you. See, delta U is equal to Q minus P into delta V. We have got that relation. Now, suppose the change occurs at a constant volume. A change occurs at a constant volume. That means, state one, volume is equal to 1 liter. State two, volume is equal to 1 liter. 1 liter, there is no change in volume. If it is so, what will be the change in volume delta V, Sharon? What will be the change in volume delta V? What is the final volume? 1 liter. Initial volume, 1 liter. So difference in volume, final minus initial, 1 minus 1, that is equal to, now you say, that is equal to, Punya, change in volume is equal to?
0.
You said anything?
0.
Zero. It is equal to 0. Change in volume delta V is equal to 0. Therefore, P into delta V is equal to 0. P into delta V is equal to 0. Therefore, you get a delta U is equal to Q when delta U is equal to Q when pressure is, volume is a constant. So you will get the relation. Delta U is equal to the amount of heat absorbed at a constant volume. See, the change in internal energy, delta U, change in internal energy, delta U, is equal to the amount of heat absorbed, Q, at a constant volume, QV, that is the amount of heat absorbed at a constant volume. So there is a relation between the change in internal energy and the amount of heat absorbed, the amount of energy absorbed. So delta U is equal to the amount of heat absorbed at constant volume, QV, that is equal to QV. Okay. So that is about the internal energy, the change in internal energy, delta U. First law of thermodynamics, from that delta U is equal to Q plus W, and W is equal to minus P into delta V. Work done on a system positive, work done by a system is negative, and delta U is equal to the amount of heat absorbed at a constant volume, that is a QV, amount of heat absorbed, energy absorbed constant volume. Now you come to another term, enthalpy. That is also an amount of energy, enthalpy H. That is also a state function. Enthalpy, it is also known as heat content. Heat content. It's an old term used, heat content. heat content or enthalpy. You need not study heat content, you study only enthalpy. So enthalpy H, that is also a state function. So the enthalpy value depends on the initial and final states only. And what is enthalpy? That is also a measure of energy. And we can write the enthalpy as H is equal to U plus PV. U plus PV. Enthalpy H is equal to U plus PV, where H is the enthalpy, U is the internal energy, P is the pressure, and V is the volume. Now, let the change occur at a constant volume, constant pressure. Then the change in enthalpy, okay, you start from H1, state 1, state 2, it is equal to H2. So the change in enthalpy change delta H is equal to H2 minus H1. Final minus initial, always final minus initial. It may be a negative value or a positive value, I told, it depends. Okay, so delta H is equal to H2 minus H1 delta H. Now, if the change occurs at a constant pressure, at a constant pressure, we can write the enthalpy change delta H is equal to, from this relation, delta H is equal to delta U plus P into delta V, because P is a constant. So P into delta V, delta H is equal to delta U plus P into delta V. From this relation, we can derive another equation. And the equation is this, delta H is equal to Q, that is equal to Q P. You study this relation, delta H is equal to QP. And what is QP? That is the amount of heat absorbed at a constant pressure. See, QP is equal to the quantity or amount of, the quantity of heat absorbed, energy absorbed at constant pressure, QP, constant pressure. You just correlate this with delta U. Delta U is also a measure of energy. Delta U is equal to QV, the amount of energy absorbed, the amount of heat absorbed at constant volume. See, all these things are holding good in the case of gaseous systems. Okay, while delta H is equal to QP, where QP is the quantity of heat absorbed at a constant pressure. So both are measure of the amount of heat energy absorbed. See, delta U and delta H, enthalpy change delta H, internal energy change delta U, both these are a measure of the energy change, heat energy change especially. Say delta U, the quantity of heat absorbed at constant volume, while delta H, the quantity of heat energy absorbed, energy at a constant pressure. So that is the only difference between delta U and delta H. So a new term is introduced, enthalpy, and it is defined like this. H is equal to U plus PV, where H is enthalpy. Then U, the internal energy, P, pressure, and V, volume. If it is so, at a constant pressure, enthalpy change, amount of heat energy change, delta H is equal to delta U plus P into delta V, P is a constant, P into delta V. From this, we can derive a relation delta H is equal to QP, where QP is the amount of heat absorbed at a constant pressure. Okay, so both these are some measures of the amount of energy, amount of heat energy, internal energy as well as enthalpy. Okay, now let us see two types of reactions you studied in the 10th standard. Exothermic and endothermic reactions. Exothermic and endothermic reactions. Do you remember this? You have studied this in the 10th standard. Exothermic means energy is released, heat is released. Exothermic means during that change, physical or chemical, whatever it is, exothermic, a change in which heat is released, evolved, heat is released, or energy is released, energy is evolved, it is given out. Well, endothermic, now do you remember endothermic? That is a change in which heat is absorbed. Heat is absorbed. Energy is absorbed. That is endothermic change. Okay. Let us take the case of the heat content value. Heat content value. See, there is a change from state 1 to state 2. Reactant to product. Okay. Reactant state 1. Product, right? See, like this. I shall show it like this. The reactant giving the product. This is state 1 R and state 2 that is equal to P. Now, the heat content or enthalpy at the state 1 or reactant, see, let it be H1. Heat content or enthalpy of reactant state 1 is equal to H1. Then heat content of a product that is equal to H2, suppose H2. Okay, now what is delta H? That's a measure of a heat energy that we know, a measure of a heat energy, delta H. Delta H is equal to H2 minus H1 that we know. Okay, see, exothermic means heat is released, heat is given out. Why heat is given out? Why is heat given out? Suppose the heat content or enthalpy of the reactant is equal to 100 joules. Suppose the enthalpy of a reactant is equal to 100 joules. The enthalpy of a product is equal to 90 joules. 90 joules. Okay. In the reactant, system one, in the reactant, the total energy or enthalpy is equal to 100 joules. Joule is a measure of energy. For work also, we use joule, unit joule. Now, the energy of the product, heat content or enthalpy of the product is equal to 90 joule. Okay. Now you take the difference. Take the difference. H2 minus H1. What will be the value? Delta H is equal to H2. Yes, one of you just try. You try at least.
90 minus 100.
90 minus, come on. 100, and that is equal to, Punya, you say?
Minus 10
joules. Minus 10 joules. So what happens here? What will be the sign of delta H during exothermic change? During exothermic change, what will be the sign of delta H? Will it be positive or negative? I told you, you take the difference, final minus initial. It may be positive or negative, that depends. Here, the reactant has a higher energy, while the product has lower energy. So when you take the difference, 90 minus 100, that is equal to minus 10 joules. That means delta H is a negative value. Delta H is a negative value. Do you get me, my dear friends? Delta H is a negative. You follow this or not? Heat is, why heat is given out? See, initially, the energy is 100. Finally, the energy is 90. In the product, there is only 90 joules. So there is a difference of 10 joules. And what must be done? Energy can neither be created nor be destroyed. And so the difference in energy, 10 joules, that is given out in the form of heat. And so the reaction is exothermic. Heat is released. Do you follow what I say? Suppose we have a large cylinder. We have a large cylinder, suppose. And let it be the reactant. And it is full of water. Large cylinder. It is full of water. Okay. Now, you have a small cylinder here. Suppose it is the product. And it can contain only less volume. Okay. What happened to the remaining volume? That will be given out. Do you follow my argument? Can you follow the argument? In the product, there is less amount of energy. In the reactant, there is more energy. So when the reactant is converted into product, the product can contain only less amount of energy. So the excess energy is given out in the form of heat. Followed this or not? You know, energy can neither be created nor be destroyed, but one form of energy can be converted into another form. One form can be converted into another form. So here, the excess energy is given out in the form of heat, and so the reaction is exothermic, heat is released, and delta H is negative. Okay. Now you come to the same argument. You come to the endothermic change. See, in the endothermic change, heat is absorbed. And why heat is absorbed? Suppose the reactant giving the product. In the reactant, there is only 90 joules. In the product, there will be 100 joules. So in the product, there is more amount of energy. So to convert the reactant into the product, what we have to do? We have to supply energy to the system. We must heat the system. Then the system absorbs energy. And what will be the change in enthalpy, delta H? It is 100 minus 90 is equal to plus 10 joules. And therefore, delta H is, you complete. For an endothermic, what will be the sign of delta H?
Positive.
What will be the sign of delta H? Delta positive. Is positive or negative?
Positive.
Unmute. Positive. Unmute and say.
Positive, sir.
It is a
positive.
Delta H, here delta H is positive. Delta H is a positive. See the difference. So delta H is positive when there is endothermic change. So from the very sign of the delta H value, positive or negative, from the sign of the delta H value, we can say whether the reaction is endothermic or exothermic, we can say. Okay. What is, maybe, come on, share one. What is endothermic reaction?
Heat is released.
Sharon is
that
not.
That is negative.
Michael, what is endothermic change? Michael, Naureen.
Heat is released.
Sharon is there. Sharon can say, what is endothermic change?
Heat is released.
Unmute. Aditya, endothermic?
Sir, a change in which heat is absorbed.
Absorbed. And what will be the sign of delta H? Come on. Aditya, sign of delta H?
Sir, positive.
This positive. This positive. Where is Krishna? What is exothermic? Krishna is there or not? Please don't waste our time. Adul, you please say. Adul, exothermic. Heat is released. Given out. What will be the sign of delta H?
Negative.
Delta H?
Negative.
So, Adul, you said it? Sign
negative,
of
sir, negative.
It's a negative. It is a negative. So from the sign of the delta H values, we can decide whether the reaction is or the change is endothermic or exothermic. Okay. Now, let us see one more point. Extensive and intensive properties. Extensive and intensive. Extensive properties. Extensive and intensive properties. Extensive and intensive properties. So, there are certain properties which depend on the quantity of the substance. The quantity of the substance. The amount of the substance. Such a property is called an extensive property. So, extensive property, it depends on the quantity, the amount. Extensive depends on the amount of the quantity depends on the quantity of the substance, the amount of the substance, that is called extensive property. Say, for example, volume, that depends on the quantity. If there is more quantity, more volume will be there. Water, 1 liter water, 2 liter water, doesn't volume depends. Volume depends on the quantity. Similarly, mass, 1 kilogram, 2 kilogram, etc. Depends on the quantity. Then you have a U, there is H, and all these are extensive properties. Extensive. So these properties depend on the quantity of these substances. While intensive properties, they are independent of the quantity. So they do not depend. They do not depend on, the quantity, of the substance. For example, temperature does not depend on the quantity. You take 1 liter water, 2 liter water, 3 liter water, 100 degree, you heat. So the amount of heat absorbed will be different. But remember, the temperature will be the same. 1 liter water, 2 liter water, you heat up to 100 degree, temperature is the same. It will not depend on the quantity. Similarly, say molar pressure. Pressure is a force per unit area. Unit area is constant. So it is independent of the quantity. So it is an intensive property. Similarly, the molar heat capacity. That means the amount of heat absorbed by one mole. That is called molar heat capacity. So you take one mole, the amount is constant. So the heat absorbed. To raise the temperature through 1 degree, that will be a constant. So molar heat capacity, that is the amount of heat absorbed. To raise the temperature of 1 mole of a substance through 1 degree, that is called molar heat capacity. Since we are taking one mole, the mass is constant. So the amount of heat absorbed to raise the temperature through 1 degree, that will be a constant. Molar heat capacity is constant, and it is independent of the quantity, because quantity is constant, and therefore it is a intensive property. Now, you study these changes at standard conditions, then they are called standard enthalpy change, standard entropy change, etc. More details we can see the next day. So far, we have seen the extensive and intensive properties. Extensive properties depend on the quantity, the amount, the quantity, for example, volume, mass, quantity. While intensive property, it is independent of the quantity. It will not depend on the quantity, the amount. Say, for example, temperature. Or a molar heat capacity, specific heat capacity at constant volume or constant pressure. So even pressure, all these things are independent of the quantity. And so all these are examples for intensive properties. So far, we have seen two types of properties for a system, especially for the gaseous system. We are mainly dealing with the gaseous system. Okay. Let me stop now. Thank you.